The next stop is Avenue J.
Franz Kafka, absolutely fascinating individual. I think you have to be a psychologist of, you know, global proportion to have any kind of understanding or insight into his work. It will be a challenge for me to say anything relevant or useful about Franz Kafka in terms of a literary analysis, but I'm hoping to place him within a Jewish context, give you some historical background that may have informed some of his rather bizarre and deeply disturbing writings, and hopefully we'll get a better sense of who he was as a person and what he represents within the greater scope of Jewish history. His years, of course, are 1883 to 1924. He died a young man of tuberculosis, but in that time he produced some absolutely fantastic, amazing literary works, some of which he published during his own lifetime, and others which he deposited with his good friend Max Brod, with the instructions that upon his death the manuscripts should be burned. His best friend, however, realizing their phenomenal value to the larger reading public, disobeyed his friend's wishes and had them published nevertheless. And so we have many great works of literature of Kafka's pen as a result of his friend Max Brod's betrayal, as it were. I want to thank in particular two sponsors we have for today's lecture. Norm Robinson, who is a great supporter of this series from California. He and his wife Bridget have come to the plate many times to make sure that everything ran well and we were able to raise scholarship funds for our students. And also an anonymous sponsor named Joseph Bienenstock, who also came to this plate and decided to help out with these lectures. We're really grateful for the sponsorships. Your attendance is sponsorship as well, but it's always nice to be able to just make it a little nicer, have the student intern and the food and so on. My research, as always, this is essentially a 60-minute book report where I read a couple of, you know, biographies and then try to present what I learned the night before in class. I mean, this is college, right? That's what everyone does here. It happens that I know a little bit more about Kafka because I read him as a young man, but I relied very heavily on this one last book in the series of the Yale Jewish Lives series, Saul Friedlander's Franz Kafka, The Poet of Shame and Guilt. You'll see that the biographies on Kafka are really, they span the gamut. There's a tremendous range of takes on why Kafka wrote the way he did. We'll have a look at it specifically from the Jewish perspective. And to that end, I want to read you one quote which I think encapsulates the entire lecture. If you have someone else, somewhere else you need to go, you could probably just read this quote and then you can leave because you will get the whole thing really within this brief paragraph. Max Brod, I mentioned earlier, his close friend, wrote a letter to him about 3 years before he passed away. And he wrote, "Most young Jews who wanted to write German," meaning write in the German language, write for a German audience, "wanted to leave Jewishness behind them, and their fathers approved of this, but vaguely. This vagueness was what was outrageous to them. But with their posterior legs, they were still glued to their father's Jewishness, and with their waving anterior legs, they found no new ground. The ensuing despair became their inspiration." Let's just unpack this strange paragraph a little bit because it really is Kafka in a soundbite. So he, of course, was a young Jew who wanted to write in German. We're going to talk a little bit about the complex nature of identity politics in Prague at the turn of the 20th century. And he wanted to leave his Jewishness behind him, meaning like so many Jews of his generation, and really the prior three generations before him, they wanted to escape into a secular identity, to be accepted within German-speaking civilization. Prague, as we'll see, is a little bit complicated, but basically it's a German, for Jewish purposes, it's a German environment. And their fathers were also part of this plan. They felt that the natural and appropriate evolution for Jews of the late 19th, early 20th century was essentially to assimilate, or at the very least acculturate, into the German milieu. So in other words, you have these young Jewish writers wanting to write in German, wanting to succeed in the German, you know, cultural sphere, and their fathers say, you know, that's really good, you're getting ahead. But vaguely, meaning they're fathers did not really want this to happen completely. They wanted them to somehow retain some Jewish identity simultaneously. They wanted them to succeed in their fields, but at the same time, they had to have some roots in their Jewish identity. And the vagueness was what was outrageous to them. Fascinating phrase, meaning the young Jewish writers thinking, well, what is it? I mean, is Judaism real? Should I be hanging on to this ancient tradition? Should I find meaning in this great conduit of civilization that has sustained my ancestors for so many generations? Or should I abandon it? Why should it be somewhere in between? The vagueness itself is the difficulty. And now, if you've read any of Kafka's works, you probably hear the allusion, but with their posterior legs, they were still glued to their father's Jewishness, and with their waving anterior legs, they found no new ground. Anyone recognize that sort of literary allusion? It's okay, if you plagiarize yourself, it doesn't really count. Actually, it does, but the metamorphosis, exactly. It's a strange sort of insectile metaphor, right? There's this bug. The Jewish German writer has posterior legs. They're stuck to Judaism like with a flypaper kind of thing. But the waving anterior legs can't find any traction in the non-Jewish world. Backwards, they're stuck in Judaism. They can't leave it behind, but they also can't move forward properly either. And that Nishtahin of Nishtaher, neither here nor there kind of position, is exactly the sweet spot for inspiration. And this is what gave Kafka his energy. Much of his writing, I think, can be boiled down to exactly this particular statement of identity. He's talking about himself. He's talking about his own appreciation of Judaism, Jewish culture, and Czech-German culture at the same time, not being completely at home in either. And that is where he derived most of his energy. That's the end of the lecture. The rest is going to be all details. Let's go into the details, though. So here's Shamsatz of his family. He was the eldest son of Hermann and Julie Kafka. The name is actually a Jewish Czech name that goes way back. The name Kafka is a type of a bird. His father was a petty businessman. He had a small store. He was the son of a shochet himself. And he does not fare well in Kafka's writings. Kafka himself, Franz Kafka, was, obsessed with his father, felt constantly unable to live up to his father's wishes, and felt in many ways that he was not half the man his father was, and resented it very deeply. Julie Kafka helped out in the store extensively, and so Franz, the eldest, was something of a latchkey kid as he was growing up, often alone, spending a lot of time in solitude, which was great for his literary genius, maybe not so great for his personal development. In fact, we have a letter he wrote to his father in 1919, 103 pages long, Briefe an der Vater, a letter to the father, which is, and imagine if Kafka at this point is 38 years old and he's writing this, essentially novella-length letter to his father in which he essentially dumps on his father for, the way he treated him and boorishness. And we're not talking about abuse here. We're talking just about a personality conflict that was very, very deep-seated for Kafka and fueled much of his own internal anxieties. He gave the letter to his mother, asking her to give it to the father, and his mother refused. Later, after his death, it came into the hands of Max Brod, who published it, so we have the entire text of it, and psychologists have made quite a bit of hay understanding the context of his conflict with his father. He had three younger sisters, or two younger brothers who did not survive infancy. He was very close with his sisters, and in fact, he lived at home until he was 31. So he was very close with all of them in every context. You notice the frightening thing, or the unfortunate sad thing about their names, is their date of death is 1944, 1942, and 1942. They were all, of course, killed in the Holocaust. We will not go into many of the other psychoanalytical topics that are associated with Kafka, but let's focus on the Jewish aspect of it. So he is a son of Prague, the great city of Czechoslovakia, which is dominated by the great figure, the Maharal, shown here in a statue outside of one of the main buildings in Prague. The Maharal, great rabbi, very prolific, the author of a large series of writings that take up on my bookshelf in an older edition about a foot and a half of deeply philosophical writings. Rumored, but incorrectly, to have created a golem, incidentally. Many people who know something about the Maharal say that he created one of these artificial anthropoids that later went and wreaked havoc on anti-Semitic circles in Prague, but that's actually a legend that's not appropriately associated with the Maharal. At any rate, Prague is a beautiful city, still beautiful today, very, got a beautiful castle that figured deeply in many of Kafka's writings. But what's important about it for us is its identity politics. Here you're going to have a look at where it is in the year 1913. This is a map of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. The red line here indicates its borders, and perhaps the most obvious thing that should jump out at you is that it is a deeply multinational empire. A very large Jewish population that were spread out from the borders of Switzerland in the west all the way out to Ukraine in the east, and it was made up of many different nationalities, many different languages, many different faiths as well. You have Christians of various denominations, Jews and Muslims all living here, and after 1863, led by a dual monarchy made up of Austria and Hungary, hence the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Prague is right up here in the Czech Republic at the very top. And Prague is a very complex spot within the larger Austro-Hungarian Empire because, first of all, it's an urban center. Jews tended to live in urban centers. There were some that lived particularly over here in northern Hungary, for example, that tend to be much smaller centers. But for the most part, Jews gravitated to cities, medium and large-sized cities. About 6% of the population at the turn of the 20th century was Jewish in Prague, which is a little bit lower than many other cities. At any rate, Prague was complex because it was a city within the Czech lands, meaning that the vast majority of the people who lived in the surrounding region, and the farms in particular, were Slavs, speaking Czech, which is, of course, a Slavic language. But the cities tend to be dominated by Germanophiles, that is, those who gravitate to the German tradition, either Germans themselves, Austrians, or perhaps, of course, Austrians speak German, same language as in Germany proper. And Jews, as a minority, tend to gravitate towards state power when they live in cities. Like, for example, if you look at Montreal, which is overwhelmingly Francophone, French-speaking, but the Jews who lived there, especially up until the 1970s with René Lévesque, who was one of the, you know, the most important separatist leaders in Quebec, the Jews in Montreal overwhelmingly spoke English because they gravitated to the dominant power in Canada, the federal government, which was English-speaking. When Quebec became much more Francophone and much more strident in its attacks on the English language speakers, then Jews migrated out of Montreal, big time into Toronto, for example, where all of a sudden the bagel consumption went up and considerably improved over the pre-Lévesque era. That was a joke too, but nobody laughed because you're not Canadians, but it was actually really funny. And anyways, at that point, after a lot of the Anglophone Jews left, then the Jewish population became much more Francophone as Jews from, for example, Morocco came there and started populating the region. But in general, Jews tend to sort of orient themselves towards the state power. So Jews living in Prague generally did not speak Czech. They oriented themselves to the Germans. They spoke German, and they wanted to identify with at least Austria, perhaps with Germany as well. Of course, if you go further, another 20, 30 years into the 20th century, this would be the starting point of World War II, because Hitler would demand the Sudeten Mountains, which are just around the outside of the Czech Republic, saying they're essentially part of Germany. Chamberlain would release them, declare peace in our times, and then war would immediately ensue. So if you were a Jew living in Prague in the year 1900, there are a lot of different competing forces trying to define your identity. Whether or not you were a Jew, whether or not you were a Czech, and the Czechs were undergoing a tremendous renaissance of their national identity at this time, whether you were a German, or whether you were an Austro-Hungarian, some kind of nationality-less member of the large federal government that included all of these different peoples. There was no strong, monolithic, single culture to which you could belong. And Kafka, like many Prague Jews, felt this kind of tension, trying to determine exactly where are they going to place their bets in terms of the national conflicts and the linguistic conflicts that were ensuing. It's also important to note that, as I alluded to when we looked at his first quote, the Jewish population internally was changing dramatically. Unlike many of the populations that we looked at in Russia and in Ukraine, which essentially had a very, you know, a domineering kind of government that was not quite totalitarian in nature, but nevertheless very crude and very boorish and very demanding in its requirements of its citizens, you know, with military service that was 25 years long and things like that. In the Austro-Hungarian Empire, it was really quite enlightened. Although Jews did not have the same level of civil and especially social rights until quite late in the 19th century, there was nevertheless a consciousness that Jews did belong in that society and that they did have some standing alongside other nationalities. Just to give you one example, you know, the Jews serving in the Austrian army were given kosher food. Like, there was just an understanding that, hey, if you're in the army and you are a citizen of Austro-Hungary, then therefore you should have some rights within that army. That just gives you a sense of the difference in tone between the Russian Empire and the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And one of the impacts that this had on the Jewish community was that they were striving to fit in a very positive way. In Eastern Europe, in the Russian regions, they were rebelling against Russian authority or capitulating entirely. But in the German-speaking lands, Germany proper, as well as the Austro-Hungarian Empire, there was a sense that maybe we can find a place of accommodation. Maybe if we just adapt our own culture a little bit, we will be able to conform and we will be able to be accepted in society as a whole. You see this much more in Germany than in Austro-Hungary, but nevertheless, there was this movement towards assimilation that was very profound, particularly in the urban centers to the west, less so in the rural centers to the east. Okay, so here's a photograph of Max Brod. I mentioned him a couple times, one of the most important associates of Kafka. He met him in law school, and he was an ardent Zionist, and he was one of the most important Jewish influences on Kafka. Also, one more detail about his life before we get a couple more details, then we'll get into his literature. So he went to law school. He didn't have a tremendous amount of enthusiasm for it. He certainly didn't want to work in his father's business. In fact, when he graduated law school and he tried his hand at litigation, he really had no taste for conflict. He really did not enjoy the rough and tumble aspects of a legal career. So he decided to take this job, which he held for the rest of his life, working in an insurance agency, adjudicating claims, which was, you know, pretty humdrum sort of desk job that was, you know, did not stand out in any way, but it masked a deeply active internal life that he could engage in with freedom once the working day was over. Here is his fiancée, Felice Bauer. He actually was engaged to her twice. He broke it off twice. He never married. He did have some significant relationships with women. Felice is perhaps the most significant because he wrote hundreds of letters to her, sometimes daily, and of course they were published as well, so now we have a good sense of what he thought of her. Actually, you add that to his diary, which was also published, and we have really quite a 360-degree view of Franz Kafka and his relationships with women. He never could bring himself to marry any of the women that he had relationships with, and of course there's a treasure trove of information about his personal proclivities that are beyond our discussion here. So let's now focus, since we have a quick overview of his life and his associations, let's look at his writings briefly, and then we will turn to the Jewish influences on them and see what we can tease out of it. So, just before the lecture, we were having a little conversation about the word Kafkaesque. This is, of course, a word that has entered the English language as a result of Franz Kafka's works. The word Kafkaesque tends to mean something which is bizarre, absurd, confusing, strangely cruel and cold, and it really characterizes much of his writings. Franz Kafka was fond of describing these surreal landscapes of the mind in which, you know, people never find out why they're being abused. There's often a lot of pain and torture involved. There's sudden, unexplained death. There are characters that seem to have no, you know, internal motivation other than pushing forward the grinding wheels of a cruel bureaucracy. It's definitely a very unusual and bizarre kind of writing. I will describe the plots of a couple of them to you in a second. And they usually end badly. Kafkaesque often implies that there's an inevitable doom at the end, that somehow these things are not going to work out right. There's often a lot of conflict with fathers and sons, with fathers often driving their sons to death, sometimes to suicide, and it's not hard to read some, you know, family conflict stories into Kafka's works. But they have like an incredible power and attraction for the human imagination. You read these stories and it's very hard to get rid of them. So I'll give you one example here. Perhaps the most famous, well studied in college is the Metamorphosis, which begins with this unexplained transformation of Gregor Samsa into a huge insect. He simply wakes up one morning and he's a bug. And he doesn't know what to do about it. He tries to communicate with his family, still living in the apartment with him. They are, of course, repulsed by him. They lock him in his room. He spends much of his time listening to his sister play the violin. There's a lot of strange conflict, and the story simply ends at that point. It's a disturbing, difficult story, just like this picture. And by the way, this picture is a shout-out to one of my friends. He looks much better over here, Michael Kegel. I guess you call him an internet personality. He puts out a lot of videos and things like that. Very smart guy, Rabbi Dr. Michael Kegel, who I went to high school with. And he reminded me of the Metamorphosis because we read it together way back in the 1980s or 70s, I guess. At any rate, the Metamorphosis is deeply disturbing. There's no explanations. Why is he transformed into an insect? And it's told, by the way, from the insect's perspective. What does he never seems to wonder deeply why I am an insect, but he worries about how he will relate to his sister and how he will relate to his parents and how the furniture is cramping him in his room. They have to take out the furniture to make it possible for him to run around the room, all kinds of things like this. Very difficult, disturbing stories. Nothing obviously Jewish about them, but as I think we shall see, there are some deeply Jewish elements that run through much of his writings. Another work, one that's my favorite in many ways, is The Trial, in which a character named K, of course, it's hard not to connect K to Kafka, finds out that he has been arrested, that he is arrested for a crime. And no one can explain to him exactly what his crime was, who is accusing him, what is the punishment, and it's all this lead up to a massive trial, and he's, the entire novel is, you know, him worrying about why am I on trial, what did I do, who is this accusing me, what's the basis of their accusations, and it's just set in this kind of like nightmarish kind of scenario, suspended in an universe that has no center of gravity to it. Very, very difficult kind of writing. Really great for undergraduates in their 20s, I think, who are, you know, amazed by those things. But when you get older, I think it's very tedious. My wife would actually hate reading Kafka. Actually, she does hate reading Kafka. But that's this is the kind of story that he writes. And he wrote several, some of which he published in his lifetime. And as I mentioned earlier, some of which he refused to publish, but he refused to destroy as well. He did destroy many of his manuscripts, but he had several stories that he said, you know what, I can't bear to destroy them. I also don't want to publish them. So they ended up in Max Brod's hands. So that's the sort of shorthand version of Kafka and his writings and his family and so on. What about the Jewish part of Kafka? Where does that come from and what does that have to do with his writings? So we know a fair bit about Kafka's internal relationship to Judaism because he left quite a literary record, his own diary, very extensive correspondence, and so on. We know that he had a kind of a perfunctory association with Judaism as a young child. He did have a bar mitzvah, which he felt was a singularly meaningless act in which he just memorized some things to say, and he went to the synagogue that his father went to four times a year, and he, you know, recited that which he had memorized, and then he moved on with his Jewish life, which was, you know, really quite tenuous, to say the best. But as an adult, he encountered first the Yiddish theater, and he was quite amazed by it. And I think this is just me and my amateur literary sensibilities being here. I think what probably amazed him about the Jewish theater, the Yiddish theater, was the fact that there was a dynamic, living tradition that he encountered that was far different from his bourgeois association of Judaism as being something dead that his father basically paid lip service to. The idea that these were young people who could get together and could put on a play in Yiddish, a language which you'll realize at the turn of the 20th century, Yiddish had barely been considered by Jews as a real language. The spelling had not been standardized until about 20 years earlier. There were huge debates over basic rules of grammar of what was Yiddish. My own grandmother, who I mentioned twice already, she never used the word Yiddish to describe Yiddish. She used the word Jewish. You speak Jewish, which of course Yiddish is the translation of the word Jewish. But it was like, that was just like we would say it's like Ebonics. It's like, that's just what ghetto talk. That's the way Jews would refer to Yiddish. They didn't take it seriously as a language, except for a few circles in Lithuania. And there were very, very few literary works that they could really stand on saying this is the literary tradition. So to see people using this kind of, you know, jargon as the basis of a living piece of theater was something that impressed him deeply. He had a brief and powerful flirtation with Jewish literature. He read Gretz intensely, Heinrich Gretz, very important 19th century historian, who was one of the first to really write in German a heroic encyclopedic history of the Jews that portrayed the Jews in a positive light, as opposed to Christian histories, which essentially tended to talk about post-biblical Judaism as a kind of an accident of history that had no real basis in historical validity and was doomed to eventually simply fade away. Gretz portrayed the Jews as a heroic, long-suffering people who nevertheless managed to rise from the ashes, phoenix-like, and create, you know, brand new civilizations and be extremely creative. And I think this fascinated Franz Kafka because he had never encountered, so to speak, the live charge, the actual AC/DC current of Judaism that really existed in his time. And he went from there to explore many, many other sources of Judaism. He became quite an ardent Zionist for a while, even toyed with the idea of traveling to Israel himself. He once wrote in one of his letters that if he did not leave for Israel himself, he would at least have traced the route on the map many times with his finger. Meaning he contemplated it heavily. He wondered if he should throw his lot in with these young Zionist pioneers. In fact, really, that's the question. Where would he grow his identity? He had seen with his own eyes this bourgeois assimilated background, which, you know, did not take anything Jewish very seriously at all. And all of a sudden, as a young man, he started to encounter people who took Judaism with great seriousness. One of his friends became a Belzer Chassid, a Baal Tshuva. He became very deeply associated with Judaism, and he was fascinated with this. Why would someone go backwards in time? Why would someone, you know, leave the modernity that was Prague and suddenly join the 15th century? How did that happen? So I would like to say that with his association with Judaism that occurred in his early 20s, he encountered many literary sources that informed his writing. I'm going to take you through three of them very briefly, and I'll leave it up to literary scholars to see if there's any merit in my personal analysis. The first influence I would like to suggest was undoubtedly Midrash. You cannot walk four steps in Jewish biblical interpretation without encountering Midrash. Now, I know that pretty much everyone in the room has a good sense of what Midrash is, but you'll forgive me if I speak for a couple minutes for the internet audience. I have 600 people in Latvia right now who are waiting. What exactly is Midrash? So I've got to tell them. Midrash is an essential aspect of rabbinic literary productivity of the ancient period. According to Orthodox theology, Midrash comes from Sinai, meaning it has the same kind of authority as the biblical text. It does not have the same authority in terms of how it is read, however. Meaning the rules of hermeneutics are quite different for Midrash than it is for biblical text. For example, as Midrash does not necessarily point to a direct and clear conclusion. I'll give you one example that I just read this morning, for example. So this week is Parshas Toldos. We're reading about the deception of Isaac by his son Jacob. And in the context of describing the relationship between the father Isaac and his two sons Jacob and Esau, the verse says that Isaac loved Jacob. Sorry, Isaac loved Esau because game was in his mouth. Game meaning not like he's got game like white guys playing basketball, but game like, you know, birds that you shoot and eat. I'm having fun. I don't know about you, but so what happened? So the standard way to read that, I think, is, you know, we know that Esau was a hunter and that he would go out and he would kill animals, and he would bring them home, and Isaac would eat them, which is problematic in terms of how things are koshered, but the idea is, reading it simply, it means that game was in his mouth, meaning that Isaac got to eat meat as a result of Esau's activity, whereas Jacob was sitting in the Beis Medrash learning Gemara all day. He wasn't bringing home any, you know, kosher rabbit stew or anything. But Rashi quotes a Midrash that says, wait a second, You assume too much with the pronouns here. Game was in his mouth does not refer to, you know, hunted food that was in Isaac's mouth. Rather, game was in his mouth, meaning that Isaac was trapped within Esau's mouth. You know, for Isaac loved Esau, for he was game in his mouth, meaning that Esau had completely fooled his father Esau into thinking that he was a very special and honorable person, not the case, and Isaac was helpless before him like a rabbit in the jaws of a hunting dog. So that one little midrash that simply points out the ambiguity of the pronoun who was in whose mouth is all over the Torah, Midrashim left and right. Some of them, however, are much more enigmatic and difficult to understand. For example, one that my good friend Rabbi Yaakov Trump spoke about in one of his classes recently, which is on the web. Maybe I'll put a little link to it here. The Medrash says, speaking about Abraham, that, and this is a very Kafkaesque Medrash, by the way, Abraham was walking along the way, and he saw a palace on fire. And he said to himself, wow, this palace must be ownerless, right? Meaning, like, who would let their palace go on fire? And the owner of the palace sticks his head out the window and says, no, this is my palace. And that's the end of the Midrash. It goes on to connect it to say this is referring to Abraham's discovery of God. But the problematic thing is, like, why is the palace owner staying in the palace if it's on fire? Why is the palace owner not asking Abraham, hey, put out the fire? What's happening in the story? Why is it on fire? It's a very, very complicated, difficult midrash, which Rabbi Trump, following Rabbi Sachs, says it's the unstated material in the midrash is what's important, that really the owner of the palace is saying to Abraham, I am the owner of this palace, I'm completely aware it is on fire, and the reason it is on fire is because I want you to act on putting it out. Similarly, the midrash is that God has left us in an environment that is imperfect, where there is cruelty and there is inhumanity, and our obligation is not to simply observe it, but to interact with it and to try to put out the fires, so to speak. Very appropriate, I think, in the context of what's going on in Israel today. Perhaps that's why I thought of it. But these kinds of midrashim, this difficult way of teasing out meaning in the biblical text, is essentially Jewish. It's been the Jewish way of studying the Bible for thousands of years, literally. Kafka certainly came across this, and in many ways, his stories are sort of twisted, lahavdil, midrashim. They're strange, enigmatic, they end up badly, unlike the midrashim that often end up very positively, but I'm sure that this literary influence was heavy in his mind. Okay, that's number one. Number two, Zionism. Like I mentioned with the context of the theater, I think just the audacity that the Jews would want to pick up and create a new national homeland in the ancient territory of Israel. That is such a shattering kind of idea. We thank God we've lived with it for 70 odd years. So for us, it's like, well, of course, there is Israel. But to put yourself back even just 110 odd years to the turn of the 20th century, to try to imagine what it must have been like for people to suggest that the Jews, who are a minority everywhere, decided to go back and retake a territory that they had lost 2,000 years ago. It's astounding. It's hard even to imagine such a thing. But people were serious about it. It was a very, very powerful movement. It swept up Jews all over Europe, and it engendered tremendous change. And Kafka, encountering Zionism as a living, breathing force, certainly had a strong impact on this. We know of this from his diaries. But I believe that this channel of meaning, this huge conduit or river of energy, is something that affected him. But if you recall, I think that Kafka was scared to step into these rivers. I think that he was fascinated with them, but I think he also felt that he would be drowned in them. He would be overwhelmed by the tremendous surge of meaning that these things would impose on him. That if he were, for example, to become completely engrossed in biblical study, what would that say about the relatively comfortable and, you know, placid pedestrian life that he had created in the insurance industry? All of a sudden, would it demand changes of his own lifestyle that he was not necessarily ready to impose on himself? He also harbored a tremendous degree of self-doubt and even self-disgust. His diaries are filled with, you know, all kinds of passages about, you know, his disgust with his own personality, his own body in particular, his sexuality, and the idea of connecting himself to a source of meaning as powerful as ancient Judaism or as Zionism was something that threatened him deeply and he was terrified of. Finally, The last influence that I think is very significant would be Hasidism in particular. Hasidism was enjoying an interesting renaissance in the 20s and 30s in particular. It's a little bit past his time, but nevertheless, the roots were there when he was becoming more engaged in Jewish things. Martin Buber, of course, wrote his famous collection of the tales of Hasidism around this time. And Hasidism was discovered by assimilated Westernized Jews as a source of tremendous poetry and meaning that could be actually applied within the Western context. They did not view the Hasidim as, you know, kind of backward peasant type Jews. Rather, they were actually, you know, somehow holding on to truths which were inaccessible to the bourgeois Western mind. In particular, Nachman of Breslov was a huge influence on Kafka, at least according to a friend of mine who did some research on this area. I didn't actually have a chance to run it down myself. But Nachman of Breslov certainly makes a lot of sense. Nachman of Breslov was one of the most enigmatic Hasidic leaders of the 19th century. He was also fairly prolific, at least in the stories that were recorded by his major disciples. And these stories often have, you know, if we can use the term anachronistically, a Kafkaesque kind of element. So for a couple of examples, and you can see I hope you'll see the Kafka echoes in them. The famous story of Rabbi Nachman of Breslov about the prince who thought he was a rooster. So it's a famous story. Basically goes like this. There's this prince who thinks he is a rooster, and he spends all his day naked on the floor, pecking at little bits of corn or whatever he can to eat. His father, the king, and by the way, in Breslov's stories, the king is usually a metaphor for God, is distraught and has no idea what to do. So he calls all kinds of doctors, and no one can cure the son who thinks he is a rooster. Finally, this one sage comes, and the rabbi says, I can cure him. So the king says, really? He says, yeah, the only thing is you have to do whatever I say. The king says, anything to cure my son. So immediately the rabbi takes off all his clothes and goes under the table with the son, and the prince looks at the rabbi and says to him, what are you doing here? And he says, what do you mean, what am I doing here? What are you doing here? He says, well, I'm a rooster, I'm eating, you know, crumbs off the floor. And he says, I'm also a rooster, I'm also eating crumbs off the floor. So the prince, you know, accepts that. Then the rabbi signals to one of his attendants, who throws him a pair of pants, and he puts on the pants. And the prince says to him, what are you doing? He says, what do you mean, what am I doing? I'm putting on pants. And the prince says, but you're a rooster. And the rabbi says, you think a rooster can't wear pants? Look, I can wear pants. So the prince looks at him and says, I guess so. And then he calls for a pair of pants, he puts on a pair of pants. And this goes on until eventually the prince is sitting at the table, fully dressed and behaving like a prince in every way. So that's a Breslov story. It ends there. And of course, you wonder, well, what happened here? Was the prince actually cured? Or did the prince simply learn to adopt those behaviors that were considered socially acceptable? Nachman of Breslov does not give you that answer, but nevertheless, it's got that kind of Kafkaesque feel. It's got that bizarre element to it. Many others like this. Another one, for example, about a very short line about a year when a Chaldean, a seer of the stars, tells the king that the wheat harvest is poisoned, and everyone who eats of the wheat that year will go insane. And the king says, what shall we do? If we don't eat the wheat, then everyone else will think we're insane. But if we eat the wheat, then we'll be insane too. So the Chaldean says, don't worry, I'll mark your head and mine with ashes, and then we will eat the wheat. It's true we will go insane, but at least we will know that each of us is insane. Bizarre kind of story. I think also very Kafkaesque. If you read enough of these stories, you will also write like Franz Kafka, right? Because they have that kind of strange, enigmatic, where are they going kind of stories. Many of these kinds. So I would argue that these three elements, his encounter with Midrash, his encounter with Zionism as a modern political force, and his encounter with Hasidism, particularly the stories of Rabbi Nachman of Breslov, really find their voice in Kafka's own writings. Now, so taken all together, you know, like last week we spoke about Emma Goldman, and I have to say I found that a very difficult lecture because you know, I was excited to learn about her life. Her story was in this biography series that I've been reading all year. And, you know, she's a crusader for women's rights and social justice and things like that. But by the time I finished my research and by the time I finished the lecture, I felt like, wow, that was kind of like unsatisfying. You know, it didn't have like an uplifting ending to it. I didn't feel like I got anywhere as a result of it in terms of my own Jewishness. But with Franz Kafka, I think there's something very different here. With Franz Kafka, even though he himself remained a secular Jew, in many ways he was, you know, he viewed certain aspects of Judaism very negatively. Nevertheless, I can find a point of contact with him in my own personal, you know, limited journey into Judaism. And I can understand where he's coming from. I can understand the idea of, you know, not feeling at home in any culture. Feeling so cosmopolitan that I don't have roots in, you know, this culture, that culture, this language, that language, even English, my mother tongue. You know, why is it my mother tongue? And sometimes I read books in Hebrew and I think, you know, will my great-grandchildren be able to read anything I published in my own language? More importantly, will they want to read anything I publish in my language? No. This is fun for me. Thank you for, you know, giving me therapeutic moments. But Kafka's alienation from Judaism creates kind of like a magnetic dynamic where he's drawn to Judaism, repelled by it at the same time, wants to get drawn into the orbit of Judaism, but at the same time wants to maintain his own trajectory. And that huge tension between wanting to be absorbed within Judaism and at the same time wanting to maintain his own way of thinking about things is really what generated a huge amount of energy that was ultimately expressed in his literary works. So I think reading Kafka, even though it's painful and sometimes very difficult, I would especially avoid the short stories. Those tend to be much worse even than The Trial or Metamorphosis. But reading them again with a view to thinking about the Jewish condition, I believe will generate quite positive and powerful insights into the nature of Jewish identity in the modern world. And with that, we have to conclude with his death. He contracted tuberculosis in 1917. He broke off his engagement with Felice in large part because he saw that at the time this, of course, was an incurable disease. And ultimately, he passed in 1924. But his legacy, you know, is phenomenal. He's a truly original writer. There's no one at all like Kafka in the Western canon of literature. He had a huge impact on all post-war writings, to be sure, because of that ambiguity and of the lack of meaning that, or the desire for meaning with the lack of it present at the same time. And so he's had really a phenomenal impact on thinkers for the last century. With that, I want to thank you again for your attention and your endurance. You've really been great to talk to. I've learned a lot about myself in this psychoanalytic session. Thank you very much for coming.
Stand clear of the closing doors, please.